Welcome everybody to Lecture 4, Information Retrieval in the Winter Semester 2017-2018. It's very funny, so today is about compression, codes and entropy. And today I will talk about your experiences with exercise sheet 3, which was efficient list intersection. And then we talk about compression, which saves space and query time, and I will explain to you why. We will talk about a number of codes, Elias, Gollum, variable byte, and a few more, and then about entropy, Shannon's famous theorem. The exercise sheet will be entirely theoretical. This time, three nice proofs, which will help you to deepen the understanding gained from the lecture. So we will take a break from implementation work this week. So let's first talk about the last exercise sheet, which was a lot of implementation work or implementation heavy again. So many of you like this, the topic and also the exercise. It was about performance tuning, algorithmic as well as non-algorithmic. So it was very interesting to see what you can, what you could achieve by performance tweaks, taking care of caching effects and so on, branch prediction, but also better algorithms. So let's see. Yeah, for some of you, Python was disallowed because efficiency and Python are mutually exclusive, mostly unless you do some deeper stuff there. So it was Java or C++. Yeah, one problem with Java, many of you found, when you do runtime tests with Java, there can be very large variations in runtime. You run it once, you get a runtime, you run it a second time, it's 20 times faster or 20 times slower. So it's not so clear what to do then. So I took a note and I think we give more precise instructions there next time. One thing you could, of course, do is you just average over a large number of runs. That's maybe also not the right thing to do. Another thing to do is, I think, what's the best thing to do, you just ignore the first 5 runs. So here are a number of reasons. So Java has a has the bytecode, which is compiled on the fly, and then it has just-in-time compiler. So it decides at some point when it feels like it to compile this once and for all and then run the machine code. So from then on, it's faster. There's garbage collection, which can kick in any time and ruin your runtime. And then there are caching effects, which you also have in C++. So yeah, what many of you found, it was surprisingly hard to beat a baseline. So we had a very simple baseline, which was the algorithm from the first lecture, just a zipper linear time. Yeah, very simple, algorithmically okay, but not great, linear time. We had much better algorithms, but they were also much more complex. Yeah. So one of you wrote, and I think this person speaks for many of you, yeah, you tried to improve something, and then it actually got worse. And this is actually a very important lesson from this lecture and also from this exercise, that if you have a baseline, which is simple, and you implement it really well, then it's really hard to beat. Yeah, because when you add something, it's maybe more clever, but it's also more complex. And by this more complexity, you can actually make it worse. So this was actually intended. So let's just look at the results. I'm so happy that my keyboard works now. Here's the result table. There we go. It's a very nice table. So we see here three pairs of query. How are the queries designed? Let me just go back to the slide. Oh yeah, the dude never actually bolts, and we'll come back to that. So there were three inverted lists of different lengths, a very long one, medium-sized one, small one. Why was this done like this? So there was one query, which is the first one here, which had a very large ratio. So a very long list and a much shorter list, yeah? And this should help the clever algorithms, right? Because now you can really skip across a lot in the longer list, yeah? And you can see here in this first column, this is the ratio between your improvement and the baseline. And here, yeah, you could achieve things up to maybe magnify this a little bit. There are factors 6, yeah? 6 times faster, which is also not huge, but not bad, right? 6. And some of... all of you achieved some speed up, right? Let me go back. So the second query was bowling and rock. So 25, that's still a lot. One list is 25 times longer, right? But this was already much harder. Yeah, here you have speedups of a factor of 2, and there were some of you who didn't manage to achieve a speedup, right? So size difference of 25, you can skip across some bytes, but not so many, and the added complexity makes it harder. And then there was one where the list length ratio was 15, and there it was even harder. And you can see it here in this even smaller factors of many of you had a factor, or some of you even below 1. That means your improvement actually made it worse. Of course, you could have just used the baseline, and then it would have been 1.00. Yeah. And yeah, so here all these algorithmic tricks helped, and here helps a little bit, but not too much. And here doing the complex thing can actually make it worse. Yeah. And of course, all three combined gave you the movie The Big Lebowski. Only hit. Yeah, the fact that Rock really tied the room together was mentioned 4 times. Some of you said they could answer it. They didn't even have to look it up because they knew the movie by heart, yeah? And the script as well. Okay, so let's talk about compression now, the contents of today's lecture. So what's the motivation for compression? Inverted lists can become very large. We already gave you some collections which are not super small. So we had 1.something million for film, yeah, because every movie description contains the word film somehow. And a recall, length of an inverted list is just how often does that word occur in the whole collection, right? That's just the same thing. Now in a web scale collection, these lists are huge, right? So Google also has an inverted index or some variant in it. And there the length can be tens of millions, hundreds of millions, or yeah. Let's just check. Actually, you can check the inverted index list length by just going to Google. Let me see. I'm at google.com here. Yeah, let me just type algorithm. So now I get algorithm, and what do I get here? It says 161 million results, right? That's the number of documents containing the word, which means it's the size of the inverted list for algorithm, right? And if I, yeah, I think I have another word on my retrieval, it's 660 million, right? This is the size of my inverted list, so that's really huge. So 1 million was added since yesterday when I tried it. Let's maybe put the 1 here. I'm so happy that my keyboard works now. So great. Yeah, so you have very huge inverted lists, so it's obviously important to somehow compress them so that you save space, right? Because it takes space to store them. But actually, compression can also save time. And this may be not so obvious. So let me explain to you why compression does not only save space, but also time. So first, some before I explain that, let's have two scenarios. One is where the index is in memory, right? Then obviously it saves space. Not only that, an index without compression, it might not fit into memory, and now it fits into memory, right? That's of course great, because reading from memory is much faster than reading from disk, right? So it's always... And here are some numbers. So reading from memories, you can read 2 to 6 gigabytes in a second, depending on how exactly you implement it. This is kind of what DDR3 RAM can achieve in the very best case. If you read from disk, that's a typical number, 50 megabytes. If you have parallel disks or RAID system, you might achieve up to 0.5 gigabyte, but that would be top of the performance of a disk. Disk is much slower than memory, right? So if you can cram things so that they fit into main memory, this gives you a great speed advantage. So when things are on disk, which is the typical thing if you have a really big index like you have at Google, or if you have a search engine searching a lot of things, again, you save disk space. Now disk space is not such a problem, right? It's not so hard to buy a petabyte even of disk space, right? But it also saves query time. And here's an example which shows you why. Let's assume these numbers. You have a typical disk which can you can read stuff at 50 megabytes per second, right? And now I have a compression scheme which compresses my data by a factor of 5, right? And I have an inverted list of size 50 megabytes, which means if I compress it, it's only 10 megabytes, right? And my decompression time, so I read it from disk, and now I have to decompress it, because I have to work with the decompressed version, is 30 megabytes per second. Now, if I read it uncompressed, 50 megabytes, it will take me 1 second, right? If I read it compressed, right, it will take me 0.2 seconds, is that correct? Oh yeah, because it's 10 megabytes compressed, and I can, yeah, in 1/5, right, of a second, I can do it. So in 0.1 seconds, in 1/5 of the time, I can read the data. Now I have to decompress it, which also takes some time, let's say here, for the sake of example, 0.3, which means together it's 1/2 a second, right? So I'm paying something because of the decompression, but I can read it much faster because it's less. And this is usually the dominating factor if you have your index on disk, reading it from disk, right? You pay something on top for the decompression, but you still save something. So in this example, which is fairly typical, when you implement it properly, you can save a factor of 2 in time, just by having your stuff compressed. So, and compression, it's not just a theoretical thing. All the big companies, everybody will do compression, right? Because of these reasons, save space, but more importantly, time. Yeah, you will always use compression. So compression is a super important topic, which is why we will talk about it for the whole lecture now. How do you compress an inverted index? Well, here's something called a gap encoding. Here's an example inverted list, so that's how they look like, how we have worked with them. It's just the doc IDs in sorted order, right? In sorted order so that we can intersect them fast. Now, how did we store them so far? Just one integer for each number, right? Yeah, what's the problem? You need an integer, a whole integer, which is 4 bytes or even 8 bytes, right? That's just, when do you need 8 bytes? Just to clarify, I hope my pen works. This is also a bit problematic, but let's see if more than 2 to the 32, which is approximately 4B documents, right? I mean, in a 4-byte integer, you get 2 to the 32, 32 bits, so that's about 4 billion, which is a pretty large number. Yeah, but if you have more than 4 billion, which you have if you do web search, you actually need 8 bytes per bit. Actually, Google, for the longest time, they in the beginning, they had this counter number of documents indexed. They were very proud of it because they had the most documents. Today is not so much about number of documents, but more quality. You can't index, or you shouldn't index everything anyway, because there's so much trash. But in the beginning, they had this counter, and it was always increasing, because they found more space and more clever ways to store things. And then it stalled eventually at this magical number, 2 to the 32, right? Which you could see it, the number was exactly 2 to the 32, and then it didn't change for 6 months or so. And then suddenly it changed, and it was exactly twice that number. So they found an additional bit, they did something clever, right? They had an index here and another index there, 2 indices, basically. And then after that, they switched to a different system with, and then, so they actually stored it like this, right? So they had the int hard-coded, and then eventually they didn't show it anymore. And today it's about 50 billion what's indexed. So one simple trick is you just store the differences from one item to the next, for example, doc IDs here, right? Instead of storing this, equivalently, you can store this from just the difference. To the beginning, let's say it's an imaginary 0 plus 3, difference from 3 to 17 is 14, 17 to 21 it's 4, and so on, right? Now this is equivalent information if you go from left to right. You just have to sum these up and you get these numbers, right? So what's the advantage? This is called gap encoding. And the advantage is here you have numbers which are small in the beginning but large in the end, so you need a lot of bits to write them down. Here you have numbers which can become large, but most of them are small, right? So this looks good for encoding, right? And this is typical. So you have many small gaps. If you have runs of numbers here, you will have plus one, plus one, plus one or so. Sometimes a slightly bigger number, but never huge numbers. So this is now our topic. We have numbers. Sometimes they can be large, but usually they are very small. How do we say store them in little space? Now, let's just look at the binary representation. That's our baseline now, right? This is a binary representation. And for what follows, it will be good to just write down. Let's take, why not take orange? No, I think I prefer dark red. So the number of bits I claim, let's just look what's... So this is number one. So if we take logarithm of two of the number one, yeah, logarithm two of one is zero, rounded down is zero, plus one, that's one, right? So that's correct. So let's take the logarithm of two, the number two. That's just one, rounded down is one, plus one is two. And indeed, you need two to in binary to write down two, right? This is the binary representation. Let's do just one more, or two more maybe. Log two of three, yeah? It's always a little tricky to figure out whether you should round up, round down, plus one, minus one, zero. Log two to the three, right, that will be one point something, but still not two. Only if you have four here, it will be two. So it will be the same, right? It will also be two. And now I hit a boundary here when I have log two of four plus one. So that's now two, rounded down is two, plus one is three. And indeed, four is the first number where I need three bits, right? So this is this encoding. So this is... Yeah, can you do it better? Doesn't look like you can do it better, right? And it's optimal in a sense. We will see it later. So yeah, let's just use this for gap encoding, right? I have some gaps here, 3, 14, 4. Let's just encode them like this. 1, 1 for 3, 14 is 1, 1, 1, 0, 4 is 1, 0, 0, and concatenated. So what's the problem? Do you see a problem with this encoding scheme? Yeah? How to decode, right? Very good. So here's an example. Yeah, let's decode that sequence. Yeah, how do you decode it? You go from the left and now, what do I decode, right? I could say, okay, this 1, 1 is certainly plus 3. This is what was intended, right? But it could also be like this. Maybe these 3 ones were a 7 and the 1, 1, 0 was a 6 and the 1, yeah, or like this, right? I mean, the problem is, I will often, when I draw this, draw vertical lines, but when you store the bits, you can't draw vertical lines here. I mean, you would also have to encode that here the code ends, right? If you just concatenate the bits, there's no way, yeah, it's not, there's no unique way to decode it, right? So, and what does this mean mathematically? It means that some codes are prefixes of other codes, obviously for the binary numbers, right? So 7 is 111, our binary code, and for 3 it's 11. And 11 is a prefix of 111, and that's the reason why you can't tell when going from the left when to stop, right? So that's why you have the central notion of prefix-free codes, or sometimes also just called prefix codes, where no code is a prefix of another, right? And then when you go from left to right, it's unambiguous, right? Because no code is a prefix from another, you just go until you have a full code, and then you can stop because there will be no other code which has this as a prefix. And now we will look at a number of prefix-free codes. Some historical ones, and then some which are, yeah, all of them are used in practice, but some more, some less, right? So this is Elias, and let's just Yeah, we will do a lot of examples now. So that's one of the simplest one, and it's actually not that bad because it will have a code length of twice the optimum. So this was code length for the binary encoding. Now we have a factor of 2. You're paying something now for the prefix freeness, right? And let's look. So we have, let's encode the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, and then maybe also 10. Okay, and so what do we do? Let's maybe use green for the, yeah. So first we write log 2 x zeros. What's log 2 1 rounded down? That's no zeros. And then we write x in binary. Let's just do a few examples. X in binary, and let me write that like this. So this is just this number in binary, 1. So now for 2, we first write log 2 of 2, round it down, it's 1, zeros. So I write a 0 here. And now I write the number 2 in binary after that, which is 1, 0. Now for 3, I first write leading zeros, which is log 2 of 3, round it down, that's also 1, 0. And then I write 3 in binary. Yeah, it's very simple. Now for 4, log 2 of 4 is 2, rounded down is 2, which means now I have 2 leading zeros. And now I write 4 in binary. Yeah? Which is 1, 0, 0. And let's also do 10, a little bit bigger number. So you tell me what's log 2 of 10 rounded down? It's an integer. Tip. Are you listening? Log 2 of 10 rounded down? 3. Yeah, it's 3, right? Log 2 of 8, and then between 8 and 16, it's 3. Exactly, so it's 3. 1, 2, 3. And now I write 10 in binary. What's 10 in binary? 101. 1010, right? Yeah. 1010. Yeah. Okay, that's the scheme. And yeah, this is easy to see. So you have this number of zeros. Just check, right? You always have a 1. The first red digit is always a 1, because when you write a number in binary, you use the minimal number of bits, which means you have a leading 1. If you would have a leading zeros, you would just omit them, right? It's like decimal numbers. You don't write leading zeros. You don't write here 0, 0, 1, 9, 2, 3. You leave them out, which means the first digit is always non-zero, which for bits means it's a 1, right? So you have this 1 here, and then the green part is just as long as what comes after the leading 1, right? So it's exactly twice the length of the green part plus 1, right? So this is obviously true. Now, why is it prefix free? Because, I mean, I'm wasting something here, a factor of 2. Why do I do this? Because if I now come from the left, I just read how many zeros are there, right? I mean, I don't store the colors, they are just for explanation, but I can just count the number of zeros until I hit the 1, right? So here I have 3 zeros, and now I know there will be a 1 and 3 more digits, right? So I know when to stop. And because of this, it's prefix free, right? These two mean the same thing. Prefix free means going from the left, I know where my code will stop. And there is no other code which will be a continuation of this. Any questions about this simplest of codes, Elias Gamma? Okay, so now a natural question is, can we improve this? This wastes a factor of 2. Can we improve this? And yes, we can. Here's this is Elias Delta. And this is a typical trick which you use an encoding and use it to make a more intricate encoding. Where do we waste stuff? We are writing these this green thing is like a unary encoding of the number log 2 of x, right? Unary is you want to encode 10, you just write 10 zeros, right? That's a bit wasteful. So let's just encode this green part again with a code. And let's just use Elias gamma for this, right? So let's just... you can read this in the meantime. Maybe I just copy here the Elias gamma codes. So Elias gamma, this is the one from the previous slide. Elias gamma. This was for 1, I just have the 1. For 2, I write 1 leading 0 and 1 0. Right? For the 3, I have 1 0 and 1 1. And then for the 4, I have 2 leading zeros, a 1 0 0. Right? Once you understood it, it's really easy. So now let's do Elias delta, which is also easy if you understood it. Let's just do the same numbers here, 4, and let's also do the 10, right? So what do we do? We log 2x plus 1 in Elias gamma. So we first encode the number of leading zeros from Elias gamma using Elias gamma. Let me just do it and then explain the plus 1. So let me also do this in a green here. Yeah, green. As I said, green. But the pen is working better than expected. Yeah, and then again followed by x in binary. Yeah, so just the leading part is without the leading one. I'm omitting the leading one. We will see in a second why. So what is log 2 of 1 is 0 plus 1. So I first write 1 in Elias gamma, which is this 1. Let me first do all the... Okay, x in binary would be 1. Without the leading 1 is nothing. So I just leave it at that. So for 2... and 3, it will be the same prefix, that's log 2, it's 1, plus 1 is 2. So here I will write 0, 1, 0. And here I will also write 0, 1, 0. And now I write this number in binary, but without the leading one. Yeah? So this would be 1, 0, and I just write 0. And this would be 1, 1, and I just write 1. So for the number 4, this would be 3 here, and 3 in Elias gamma is 0, 1, 1. And now I write the 4 in binary, which is 1, 0, 0, and I omit the leading 1. And let's do one more. 10. What's log 2 of 10? We already had that. It's 3 plus 1 is 4, which means the prefix will be 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. What do I write here? What should I write in red? First, how many bits? 3, yeah, 3 bits, because 10 is 4 bits in binary, and I omit the leading 1. And which 3 bits? There are only 8 possibilities. 0, 1, 0, that's exactly right, yeah? So I'm just omitting the, yeah. That's it. So, why plus 1 here? I mean, you see it's actually... So, interestingly, the first for 2 and 3, the codes actually become longer, right? You have to pay somewhere. But eventually, they will become shorter because I'm encoding this number in with a code and not in unary, right? So, I'm actually paying my log 2 of x, which is for the binary here. And this here, I'm encoding log x with Elias gamma, which is 2. Log of whatever you encode. So I'm paying 2 log for this. And then, some extra bits there, right? You can also write down the exact number, which has more floors and so on, but yeah, so it's the optimum plus 2 log log, which is better than what we had before. Why this plus 1? Does anybody have an idea? Why not just write log 2x rounded down in Elias gamma here? I mean, plus 1 just makes it longer. Because there is, I'm sorry, the writing does not work up here. There is no code for 0, right? In it's a very simple reason. I mean, Elias gamma, the code start, you can encode 1, 2, 3, 4. There is no code for 0, right? So if you would have 0 here, how do you encode it if you don't have a code? So it's just shifted by 1 in Elias gamma. And let's take a minute to understand why it's prefix free. You go from the left. The green part, it's a prefix-free code, Elias gamma, so you know when the green part stops, right? And this green part, if you decode it, it gives you the number of bits that follow, right? So 0, 1, 0 is actually 2 in Elias gamma, and it's 1 more than the number of bits that follow. And because this is prefix-free, you don't need this leading 1 here, right? You know where the green part stops because it's a prefix-free code. Any questions about this? Mm-hmm. I hope you understood it. Okay, here's another one. Golomb, not Gollum, yeah? Solomon Golomb, alive until recently, but not anymore. So, this is also important encoding. It has a parameter m. And then what you do is very simple. There's a q and an r. So let me just use my usual colors here. So q. Q, because this is just the quotient. Wow. These little things are so annoying. I can't write up here. I will just do it. I think I can write here. Yes, here it works. So Q, because it's quotient, you can already read the slide, and R is the remainder. And let's just look an example and do what's written here. Yeah, let's do one example. Let's take where's my keyboard? It's hiding. Do I have more? No, I don't have more. Let's do an example. Let's do x, let's do modulus 16 and x, which x do you want? A number between 50 and 100, please? 42. Okay, you wanted it, 42. Let's see, 42. So let's first compute the Q. So Q is 42 div, yeah, which is just the integer division, 16, which is? 2, yeah, it's 2, right? It just fits in there twice. 2, which means in unary, right? This is 0, 0 in unary, right? In unary, so let's do the same thing for the remainder. So the remainder is 42 mod 16, which is what? That's just the remainder if you divide by 16. So these two characterize the number 42. 10, yes. That's 10, right? You subtract 32, you get 10. And 10 in binary, we know that by now, is 1, 0, 1, 0 in binary, right? So you see it's very common to have a unary and binary encoding. So the Golomb code is So the code is column code. Code is, yeah, you just write 0, 0, right? You just write the 0, 0. Then you write a single one as a delimiter. Let me do that in blue. And then you write this part. 1, 0, 1, 0, right? So let's check how many bits do we need. Why is it prefix free? I think that's, because you have this one here, you just know when the zeros stop, you just read how many zeros. That's a unary encoding, a number of zeros ended by one. So you know it's 2 here, right? You can read off the queue going from the left. And M is fixed, right? The modulus is fixed. So 16, you know that it's 4 bits which follow after that, right? That's the principle of Gollum encoding. Okay, how many bits do I need? Q written in unary with zeros. Let's just write that down. That's it's just x divided by m rounded down, right? That's into that, and that those this many bits, a single one. Well, a one takes 1 bit. I wrote it in blue. 1 bit, and r written in binary. That's it depends on the size of the modulus, which is, do I have to round it up or round it down? If my modulus is M, so 16, it just works, yeah? Log 2 of 16 is 4. Do I have to round it up or round it down here if my M is not a power of 2? I don't hear you. Need a microphone? There are 50-50 chance of getting it right. But your modulus is m, right? Which means you have to store numbers from 0 to m minus 1, m different numbers. How many bits do I need? Can I do it with log 2 m rounded down? Or do I need log 2 m rounded up? Have to round it up, right? If you round it down, you can't, this is important for what follows also. Sometimes you just have to round so that you can accommodate everything, yeah? Mm-hmm. So this is important because this will be one of the exercises, right? You have to show something about Gollum and you have to argue with the number of bits. So it's x divided by m plus 1 plus log 2 m for modulus m. Any questions about this scheme? So, I think there's one more, and also one more example, and then we skip to the interesting theory part. Variable byte encoding. Variable byte is actually a very simple. Now, what do you see? Imagine you would have to implement this, right? Now you have a code which has 7 bits, right? And you have to somehow pack this into integers, which means you can do it, but it's a bit fiddling thing, right? This is it's actually not so not nice to implement, but it also costs something, right? So bit fiddling can be a complexity problem or a runtime issue, right? So variable bytes is something where you always store your code in whole bytes. And actually, if you know UTF-8, they use variable byte encoding. And this will be a topic in lecture 7. So let's just look at an example. And let's, I want a number. Yeah, you pick the number. For example, let's take, I want a number between 500 and 1,000, please. That was an easy question. So? 542, that's a beautiful number. Let's see whether it will work. Okay. So what I do now, so let's first do I want to store this in, obviously one byte is not enough, but two bytes should, yeah? You can use a whole number of bytes, one byte, two bytes, three bytes. We should be able to store this in two bytes. So first, what is 542 in binary? Yeah, let's first do x modulo, and I want to, in the first byte, I want to write, let me show you how I want to do this. I want to do, so my code is like this. I want to write it in two bytes. First byte and second byte. So this is my byte one. And this is my byte two. And now I have one bit which is reserved for, is this the last byte of this code? I need to tell where, even if I do it byte-wise, I need to tell where it ends, right? And I will do it like this. So here I will write, and these signaling bytes, I always draw them in green, one, yeah, and zero. This was unintentional, this, let me draw it again, one, zero. So this says that there are more bytes to come. Yeah, this is the code will continue. I mean, you could also do it the other way around. Look, and this says that this is the last, that this is the last byte of the code. So if I press only slightly hard, it will, and it will also not work down here, so it's really, it's increased difficulty, level, high level. So and now I have to write my data here. So let's, how do I do it? So I have seven bits here and seven bits here, that should be possible. So I first have to take this modulo 128, right? Because I want, what is it, modulo 128? Or let's first do it diff 28. That's easier. Diff 128. So how often does the 128 fit in there? Four times? Yeah, because 512, right? So this is four. And I think I will write this in a green. So let's do that. So let me do it like this, x diff 128 is 4, and 4 in binary is 100 in binary, right? Yeah, and this is just what I will, I should have written this in red. I'm sorry, I will have to do it again. But that's no problem, because in the meantime you can figure out what is 542 modulo 128, which is not that hard. So, x diff 128, and I will also already write it down here, modulo 128, right? So this is 4, and this is 100 in binary. So 4, 512, that's easy, right? 512, so it's 30. What's 30 in binary?
1, 1, 1, 1, 0.
Are you sure?
Sure.
1, 0, okay. Yeah, because 32, right? 31 would be 5 ones, and 30 is the one. Yeah, very good. So it's actually Yeah, probably there will be an exam question about this. So, what do I do now? So I just write this code here. So I just write, you could do it in a number of ways. 100, and now I have to fill this up with zeros, right? I need so 4 more, and I think I should space these out evenly. So let me try that. So that will be 100000, right? So that's 7 bits here, and here I need 2 more bits. 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. Oh, it's not so easy, I'm sorry. This needs to be evenly spaced out, otherwise the code does not work. So it's 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, right? So code point, let me just, if I just take the, so the code point is, the so-called code point, right, is, so the actual code is just, you take the red parts, right? You just take, so it's 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, and here is a, and then I take 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, which is exactly 542 in binary, or should be, which is 542 in binary. Yeah? So that's variable byte encoding, which you use a lot in practice. In particular, UTF-8 codes, which we'll talk about later, are variable byte encoding. Any questions about this? And of course, this also works for larger numbers, right? Then you do 128, and then 128 square. You always have 7 bits per per byte for the encoding. Oh, there's double light now coming from there. Any questions about this? Okay. So I think there's one more code. No, I will just talk about this. So there are so many codes around. Yeah, there's huge variety. Why are there so many codes around? Well, there are different aspects which are interesting. The three most important ones are space reduction, right? You want it to compress a lot, but then you also want to do the compression fast and the decompression fast, right? And it's kind of hard to get all three. There will be different trade-offs, and that's why you have so many schemes, right? There's a very recent scheme. Now, people have done research on these schemes for decades, so it's quite interesting that there are still new schemes coming up. And actually, in 2014, so very recently, there's a completely new scheme which nobody has thought of before. Every compression code researcher is angry that they didn't come up with this themselves. It's called asymmetric numerical systems, and it has a very interesting trade-off between space reduction and decompression speed, right? So it reduces really well and decompresses really fast. It's actively used, actually, at all the big companies, not for everything, depends on the application. We will talk about that in a second, when will you use which code. And the basic idea is you take a whole message, not each doc ID, but the whole thing, and encode it into one big integer, right? It's an arithmetic encoding. And interestingly, it's very easy to implement. It's very little code, but it's super hard to understand mathematically. So I would need at least 1 hour to explain it to you. But I just wanted to mention it because it's used in practice, it's very recent, and it's very nice. For those of you who are interested in these kinds of things, check out the Wikipedia article. You won't be able to understand it from the Wikipedia article because I think it's written by the guy himself, or at least, but you get the idea, and then you can try to work it out yourself. There's also a paper about it, which is also hard to understand. There are some follow-up papers, which I think explain it clearer. So if you are interested, check this out. It's super, super interesting. Okay, now we talk, now the theoretical part. Why? I mean, the question is, which code do I use, right? There are so many codes around, just which one is the best? Yeah, I mean, it depends, right? Yeah, but what does it depend on, right? Yeah, and it depends on, I mean, you want to encode something, and you have symbols, for example, in natural language, yeah, you have, let's say you want to compress text now and not Docker IDs, just for the sake of explanation, an E is much more frequent than a Z, right? So you should have a code for E that is much shorter than the code for Z, naturally, right? This would benefit the length of the whole message. Okay, and now we want to work with this a bit more mathematically, so we need to make this more precise. So entropy, this captures exactly what I explained on the previous slide. It's defined for, let's just look at the definition first, for a random variable X, which just has a finite range for now. Let's just take the numbers from 1 to m, so these are our symbols now. Let's say we have m different symbols, so for the alphabet would be 26, for example. And now, this has a probability distribution, which means what some of these things are, yeah, each symbol has a certain probability, and the probability is summed to 1. And now the entropy, you define it as this thing. Yeah, you can't understand now why, but that's just the definition. You can define it, right? Sum pi log 2 pi, and then a minus in the front. And we will see that this actually captures the optimal number of bits if you want to encode a symbol. Yeah, from this with this probability distribution. Let's just do one example. Let's just compute this. Let's just do this computation here. So for this, if all symbols are equally likely, 1 over m, what do we get? Well, we get, let's just do the definition. We have m symbols. Each has a probability 1 over m. And then I write log 2 of pi, which is 1 over m. Now, all the things which I sum up, they don't depend on I, because they are all the same. So it's minus m times this, m times 1 over m times. So computing with the entropy is always very beautiful, because always very beautiful things come out. M times 1 over m cancels out. Minus log is just log 2 of the reciprocal, which means it's just log 2 of m. That's it. Yeah, so this weird formula, actually interesting, or yeah, not so weird things come out, right? So the entropy of this probability of the uniform distribution over m things is log 2 of m. And then when you think about it, what do you do if you have m symbols and they are all equally likely? You will just encode them with log 2 m bits, right? That's the best you can do if they're equally likely. It doesn't make sense to give one symbol a longer or shorter code, right? So that's the best you can do, and that's exactly what the entropy is, log 2 m. Yeah, so entropy has, yeah, this definition looks weird, but it's actually the optimal number of bits for a certain distribution. And here's a super famous theorem, and we will actually prove it now, or parts of it, and you will complete the proof in the exercises, though that's a Claude Shannon, who came up with all this, with a coding theory and the concept of entropy and everything. So we have our random variable, and now we have, this should be an I here. Let me just, this LX should be the length of the code for I, yeah. This should be I. I think this should be I. So, I have a random variable, and now I have a code which encodes these symbols, right? And now, this code, yeah, this is a code length now, and if I take a random symbol, so this is the random variable x now, and I'm looking at the code length and I'm looking at the average, right, which is the expected value. Yeah, so the more frequent codes will be weighted heavier here then this is at least the entropy. I can't get better than the entropy. So entropy is a lower bound. Any prefix-free code, including all of the ones we looked at on the previous slides, the average code length is at least the entropy. And the other direction also holds. There always is an encoding which is at most the entropy plus one. So there is this plus one and there's a reason. You can't drop it. It would not be correct. Yeah? E is expectation, so average. So in words, no code can be better than the entropy, and there's always a code that is almost as good up to this plus one, right? So intuitively very easy to understand. Yeah, entropy just captures optimal code length. So let's prove it, and you help me. So here's the central lemma. We have a code now, and we are looking at the code length, right? So we have m different symbols, not infinitely many, but just m. And li is just the length for the ith symbol, right? Now, I say that if the code is prefix-free, then this holds for the code length, yeah? And vice versa, if you have code length where this holds, then there is a prefix-free code with exactly this code length, right? So this is looks similar to Shannon's theorem, but just with a different statement here, right? This thing here is known as Kraft's inequality. Try to understand, it's when you do mathematics, always important to get an intuition for the objects you are looking at. What does this mean intuitively? This means not all the Li's can be small, right? For example, if one Li is zero, then you have 2^0 here, which is already one, right? You have no more space for other Li's. If one Li is one, this is 2^-1, it's 1/2. You already have 1/2, right? If another code length is also one, you have 1/2 + 1/2, one, right? You can't have any other codes, which makes sense, right? If you have two codes with code length one, can only be 0 and 1, and then you can't have prefix-free code with other. For example, assume you want three symbols, and they should all have a code of length 1, right? Now, if you sum this up, it would be 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, which is greater than 1, which means it's not possible, right? And think about it. You want three codes, each 1 bit, and none should be a prefix of the other. It doesn't work. Okay, so that's what this inequality means, right? It says intuitively not all the code lengths can be small. If you have some small ones, you also need some long ones. For a long code, this number here will get small. So let's try to prove this now. Two directions. Let's assume we have a code with length such that not all the codes are short, right? This Kraft inequality. Now, forget what I just said. I have a prefix-free code with length, and it's prefix-free, right? I only know it's prefix-free, and then not all the lengths can be short. Just prefix-freeness implies this, right? Look at the following experiment. I'm generating a random code. I just pick 0, 1, 0, 1. Yeah? One bit after the other independently. Yeah? And I just do that until I get a code. Yeah, I can do that. I just 1, 1, 0, 0, 1. I can do it with Elias Gamma, for example. That's my code now. 1, 0, 0, 1, 1. And each time I check, do I have a code? Do I have a code? At some point, now only two things can happen. One is, at some point I have a code, then I stop. Or I can say, okay, there's no more code. There's no code which starts like this, right? So even if I continue, I will not ever find a code. So in both cases, I stop. So, now, let's look at the event that code I is generated, CI, right? For a prefix-free code, these events are now independent, right? That's the important observation, because, yeah, different bit sequences leading to different codes, right? So, if I have Which means, because they are independent, the probability, if I sum up the probability of getting each code, yeah, this here holds because of independence, this equality, let me just write it down, yeah, holds because of because the C1 to CM are independent. Yeah, and this just means I will generate a code, right? I mean, the complementary event would be I would not generate, I will stop with an invalid code, right? So this is just some event, and the probability is, of course, less or equal to 1. Now, what's the probability of generating a particular code? I mean, I'm picking one bit after the other. Ci. I mean, the probability is just I have to get each bit right, right? Which is I have to get the first bit right, the second bit right, and so on. And I have to do this if the code has length li. I have to do this li times, and this is just 2 to the minus li, right? Yeah. So, no, it works. Yeah, the probability of getting with this simple experiment a particular code of length li is just 2 to the minus li. I have to get all the li bits right. Right? So I just plug this in here. So this is now just, this is 2 to the minus L1, probability of getting this, 2 to the minus Lm of getting this. And if I sum these up, yeah, just by the way this random experiment works. So I prove this. Let's do the other direction. Now I say I have code length where this holds. Then I show that there exists a prefix-free code with this length. Okay, this will be... Now this is something known as Huffman encoding. So we will do Huffman encoding now on one slide. It's very nice. This, this is a nice example. It will be easy to understand. Don't give up. Let's say we have a certain code length. And let's say... Oh my, I don't... must not write... So let's say one code length is 1, one code length is 2, one code length is 3, and another code length is also 3. Let's first check whether this is possible. So the sum of, this is now 4 different codes, 2 to the minus li. Let's just look at this. So this is 1/2 plus 1 over 4, plus 1 over 8, plus 1 over 8, which is 1. Yeah? So it's okay, it's just 1, right? 1 is less or equal 1. So, which means these are valid code length. And now, what the theorem says, the lemma, we're still at the lemma, is there exists a prefix-free code which has code length 1, 2, 3, 3, right? Now imagine your task would be come up with a code for 4 symbols, 4 different codes, none should be a prefix of the others, and the code length should be 1, 2, 3, 3. And this lemma says, because this is satisfied, this should be possible. How does this work in general? Now, probably if you think about it just by playing around, you will find it out. And the way, the question is, how do you do it systematically, right? So what we do, I think I will just, you can read it if you like, or just follow my drawings. We will start with a complete binary tree. And it will look like this. Now I have to do a nice picture and I have to account for the fact that I can't draw down here, so it's really hard. But I will manage. Professional, so... I will do a binary tree here. So let's do it like this. Like this. Ah, it looks beautiful, right? And then one more. Yeah, I think that's nice. Yeah. So for my example, I have in the example, my M is 3, right? It's the maximum code length is 3, and 2 to the M is 8. I have 8 leaves, right? Here are my 8 leaves. Now what do I do for this code? I just, yeah, let me call this, I will just do this in blue also. Yeah, the left edges get a 0, and this gets a 1, this gets a 0, this gets a 1, this gets a 0, this gets a 1. Yeah, this is just what I do. And now, think about it, it's actually easy. If I just follow a path from the root to a leaf, I will get a code of length 3, right? If I go here, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, and so on. I get all the different binary numbers of 3 bits, right? Now, consider the code length in sorted order. So let's just start with, yeah, let's start with, I use 3 different colors now. Let me use L1. It's the smallest one, smallest first, so 1, right? Now, I pick a subtree with this number of leaves, right? 2 to the M minus, I pressed 2 hard, minus L1. This is a very nice scheme, right? So this is 2 to the M is 3, 3 minus 1, which means this is 4, right? I will pick a subtree of size 4, and let me just pick this one. Let me pick this subtree here, right? This has 4 leaves, right? With 4 leaves. And now I just take, I think I should draw it a little more closer to the subtree. So I think it's important that I draw a nice picture here. So I take this subtree, and I take this here. Yeah, the path leading to the subtree as my code. So the code is 0. Before I explain more, let me just do it for the next code, 2. Let me use a different number. Let me just use red. And then we need 2. Now I need a subtree of size M minus L2, which is 3 minus 2. 1, 2 to the 1 is 2. I need a subtree of size 2. And what I will argue in a second is that just by this constraint here, there will always be enough of the tree left, right? So let me just pick this subtree here. I could also pick this subtree here. It would also work, right? So now I take the path until that subtree, and I just read off the edge weight, so it's 1, 0, right? So my code is 1, 0 now. And now let me take the next code length, which is 3, and let me pick a different color, purple, lila, wonderful color, 3. Now 2, M minus L3 is 3 minus 3 is 0, 2 to the 0 is 1, which means now I want a subtree of size 1. Right? So now I'm yeah, this is the subtree, and oh no no, 1, this is not the subtree I'm taking. Sorry, the subtree is just the thing. It's just the leaf down here, right? So maybe I should, yeah, this is the subtree here, right? Mm-hmm. So now I have the path to this subtree. It's just the leaf node, which means the code is 110. Code is 110. And now one more color. What do we have? Let's take light blue. Light blue is also a beautiful color, and I hope you can see it. So it's just the same. m minus L4, so it's also size 1. And I just take what's remaining here, and I take the path until there, which is 1, 1, 1, 1. And I can't write down here, but I think this worked pretty well. So let's look at two things. First prefix, there's a problem. Are you sure? I think it's nice to have the same code for two different symbols. But if you insist, let's take a different code. Yeah. Let's look at two things. First, why is it prefix free? Now that's easy to see. The subtrees are disjoint, right? They are disjoint, which means when would I get one code which is a prefix of another? It would be the case if I, for example, this red one, I would take it inside the green one, right? For example, I would have taken this as my red subtree, and then the code would have been 0, 1, which would have been in continuation of the 0 code, right? But because they are disjoint, this is just equivalent to prefix freeness, right? It's taking a different path here. Yeah, it's not going 0, but yeah, prefix would mean subtree is contained in another subtree. They are disjoint. So now they are disjoint. If they are disjoint, you have to make sure that there is enough tree left, right? So here I wrote the tree sizes in terms of number of leaves. So this has 4 leaves, 2 leaves, 1 leaves, 1 leaf, right? Let's just sum these up. Sum up, sum I 2 to the m minus li, right? You can just pull out the 2 to the m, and then you have times sum I 2 to the minus li, right? It crops up all over the place again, right? Which is just our constraint here. And this is less or equal to 1, which means the whole, the number of leaves of all the subtrees added up is just 2 to the m, which is the number of leaves in my tree, right? So exactly if this condition holds, I have enough leaves in my tree so that I can have subtrees which do not overlap, right? And so I get my prefix-free code, yeah. And this is called Huffman encoding. This is called Can someone check how you write Huffman with 1 N or 2 N? Huffman. Let me use my press. I think 2 F's I know, but it's right with 1 N. Yeah, it's very important. It might be an exam question with how many N's do you write Huffman encoding? So, yeah, Huffman encoding, yeah? Given a sequence of code length, give me a code, yeah? So, any questions? I think that explains it very well. Okay, so we have a few more. Now let's do the source. The source coding theorem actually says you can always do a code. Yeah, can never be better than the entropy, and you can always do it with the entropy. Now, you will do part of this for the exercises, just pay attention. So this is one direction, which means whatever code I take, code length will be at least the entropy. Now it argues about average code length, so it's the expectation if I pick the code at random, right, that's the same as saying average code length, weighted average, weighted by the probabilities. The definition is just the code length summed up and the weights are the probability, right? So if a certain symbol is more likely, the number will be larger here. Now, this is given, right? We have a prefix-free encoding, which means this here holds on the code length. And now what we can do is we can give a lower bound for this number subject to this constraint. This is exactly Lagrangian optimization. Yeah, you want to minimize something under a side constraint. We did it in lecture 3 last week. or rather last year, yeah, but it's on the recording and we already used it for this galloping search proof, right? So, and with Lagrange you can show, and that's your exercise, that this expression is the smallest, I want to prove, is it at least something. So let's look at when is this the smallest. It's the smallest when Li is log 2 of 1 over Pi. Yeah? So this is something you prove for the exercise, right? And it's great to practice Lagrange. It's not very hard. If you understood it, you just write it down. It's 3 lines. And you also have to understand what is this for, right? So that you know what you're doing. Yeah. And then... okay. Yeah, let's just check this. So this is just the expected code length. It's just this. It's the definition written here again. Let me just use the arrow here. Huh. It doesn't work if I point with the... So now I said this is minimal. So the worst case, if I want to prove a lower bound, is when the Li is log 2 1 over Pi. So I just log 2 1 over Pi, and this is just the definition of entropy, right? You should understand when you compute around with these logarithm, log 2 of 1 over something is just minus log 2 of something, right? So in case you get confused, this is just all the same, right? In the definition of entropy, it's Pi times log 2 Pi and a minus in front, right? So, once you have this, the rest is easy, right? So let's do the other direction. There always is an encoding which is at most the entropy plus 1, and now we will understand why you have this plus 1 and you can't get rid of it, right? And it's also easy with what we have proven now. This is now an easy slide. So, and this number here is very important also for the other exercises. So we have our probability distribution now, and what you do is you pick the code length as log 2 of 1 over Pi. If you have a distribution, this is what you should do, right? So if a Pi is large, or let's say if a Pi is small, then this number gets large. So you will pick a large code length for things which are unlikely. If this is large, this will get small, right? So for likely symbols, you will pick a smaller code length. Yeah, and now let's just do the... What comes out here if I plug this in? So this is now... I will just do this by hand. So this is sum of I 2 to the minus... Let's just plug this in. Log 2 1 over Pi. So it's rounded up. Why is it rounded up? I have to round it up, right? I have to round it at least because the code length has to be an integer, right? It can't be a fractional number. So I have to decide rounding up or rounding down. Why do I round up? Well, you will see. This is now up here. So this is less or equal than... sum I 2 to the minus log 2 1 over Pi plus I can just leave it out, right? So this is up there. So this is greater or equal. This is greater or equal when I leave out the ceilings, log 2 1 over Pi, and now there's a minus in front, so it becomes less or equal. So what is this? 2 to the minus log 2 1 over Pi. So this is log 2 over Pi, right? It's always very beautiful with entropy how things work out. Minus something is 1 over, and then you can drop the minus, so it's 2 to the log 2 pi, which means it's just sum I over pi, which is just 1, right? And yeah, this wouldn't work if I would have floor here, right? If I would round down. I have to round up, and then I just get that the sum of these code lengths is at most one, which is Kraft's inequality, right? So this is, if I need integer code length, which I do, and I want to get as close as possible as one, then I should do exactly this, right? And this is written here again. Now I have code length which satisfy 2 to the minus li less or equal than 1, and then Hoffman encoding gives me a prefix-free code, right? And so let's just compute this, e to the lx. This is now let's just plug this in here. So this is now, this is just the definition of expectation. So this is sum I pi times, and now I have the rounded up here, log 2, 1 over pi. And now I want to upper bound this. Now I have the ceiling here. The ceiling, the worst it can do is add 1, right? Not quite 1, but very close to 1, when this is just above one integer. So this is sum I pi times log 2 of 1 over pi plus 1, which means it's, sum I pi log 2 1 over pi plus sum over pi, right? And now this is exactly the definition of entropy. And this here is 1, right? It's the sum of the probabilities. This is where the plus 1 comes from. From the rounding, you can add up to 1 to each code length, and if you just sum this up, weighted by the pi, you get the sum over pi, which is 1, right? This plus 1 comes from the rounding, right? So just by the fact that you have to round to an integer, because code length must be integer, you can get away from the entropy a little bit, but at most plus 1, right? Oh, we started 5 minutes late, but you forgot that because we erased your memory for 5 minutes. But yeah, so a few more minutes and then we are done. So this, for the exercise, you need this. So this, ideally, you should pick your code length like this, right? And it has to be an integer, so you might have to round it up. And we say, for a given the best, if you know the distribution of your symbols, this is the best code length. At most, this plus 1, right? And then we saw this, you get this, right? This is what I just did on the previous slide. And you can't get any better by Shannon's theorem, right? Up to plus 1. Now, for the exercises, it can be very hard to prove for a particular encoding and distribution this plus 1, so we will just allow a little slack, like plus 3, plus 4, plus 5, whatever you like, plus O of 1, just makes the math a little easier, right? So you have plus O of 1, yeah? We say whenever you have plus something, plus a constant, it's optimal. And you have to do some computations for the exercise sheet. Here's another definition, I just want to mention it because you read it everywhere. A universal code is when you have O of the entropy, right? For any distribution. And actually, I will not prove anything here, I will just mention it. All the codes which we have seen and all the codes which you usually see, they are universal, right? For any distribution, the expected code length is a constant factor times the entropy, right? Now, I just want to mention that this is not a very strong definition, right? So we were talking about entropy plus 1 or maybe plus a small constant, and this definition says constant factor times, right? Which means the optimal code length is maybe 5, and now it's a constant factor times 5. So this can be pretty bad, right? It's more of a theoretical result, but this is what universal defines. Now, this is one of the exercises, so let me go through an example and then we are done. It's only 2 more slides. Let's look at the simplest code which we started with, right? Which was Elias gamma, and the code length is just twice the optimum. Optimum would be log 2, yeah? Just the number of bits in binary, and Elias gamma has 2. Now, just because it's not maybe this actually it is optimal for a certain distribution of symbols, and the question you can always ask, given a code, for which distribution of symbol is it optimal? And this is the question we are asking here for Elias gamma, and for the exercise sheet you will answer this for Gollum encoding, which is a little more complicated. So for which distribution is 2 log I plus 1, and we don't care about this additive term here, so let's just look at the 2 log I. For which distribution is 2 log I log 2 of 1 over pi? Because, yeah, that's the optimal thing you should do if you have the distribution given, right? Now, so this should be this, so you have to figure out for which pi do I get this. Well, if I take pi as 1 over I squared, then just take log 2 of 1 over pi, that's just log 2 of I squared, 2 times log 2 I, right? So if you have this distribution here, 1 over I squared, then this would be the optimal code length. Yeah, you would take this as the code length. So this is the way how you do it. Now, in this case, it's not quite done. If you sum up 1 over I squared, of course, you know it's pi squared over 6. Yeah, it doesn't add to 1. But you can easily fix this. So the first term in the sum here is 1, and the remaining terms are 0.6 something. So let's just take the p1 such that, yeah? Let's just make it a little different here, and then we have found a distribution, right? You just take your p1 such that this sum is exactly 1, and the remaining pi's you take 1 over I squared, right? And then you have a probability distribution where Elias gamma is entropy optimal. One more slide, and then quickly go to the exercise sheet. That's your exercise, Gollum encoding. So I think I go over this very quickly. Yeah, we give you the probability distribution, because if we don't, it would be a pretty hard exercise. If we do, it's not so hard. So let's just take this probability. It's actually a hypergeometric distribution for those of you who like math. It's, yeah, the probability for number I is just p times 1 minus p over I minus 1. Yeah, and that's, when you think about it, that's the probability distribution of gaps in a gap encoding, yeah? And your exercise is to show that for this distribution, Gollum thing is optimal for a particular M, right? Which means, so you can choose this modulus, capital M in Gollum, such that it's optimal for exactly this distribution. And this is the distribution of gaps in an inverted list under reasonable assumptions. Which means the best way to encode gap-encoded inverted list is actually Gollum encoding. So it's good that we talked about it. However, in practice, that's not relevant for the exercise. Because of the bit fiddling, you might use another scheme, right? So let me quickly go to the exercise sheet, and then we are done. So where is it? Yeah. Don't go. We are almost done. You have to be super careful with the camera when you... So exercise one is about proving this is a Lagrangian optimization, one direction of Shannon's theorem. Great to practice Lagrange and to understand Shannon. This is about proving that Gollum encoding is optimal for this distribution, which I have just shown you, and we give you a number of hints. Plus some constants is enough. If you want to do plus 1 exactly, prepare for some extra hours. It's hard, so it's optional. You don't have to do it. But if you like math, it's a very interesting exercise, right? So we... And here, this is another interesting question. Don't be afraid of the long explanation. This is just to help you. This is just assumptions which we make, and in the end, you can just assume this, right? So you don't... you should try to understand it, but actually it's just, let's assume this. And then what you compute is, we have an inverted index, we do gap encoding with an entropy optimal scheme, which Golem would be, but that's not important for the exercise. How many bits do I need? And this is the number of bits I need. Log 2m over 2. Log 2 vocabulary size over 2 for each posting, for each doc ID, which is just good to know. And it's actually not too hard, but you have to understand what you're doing. That's it. Contents-wise, there is time for questions, of course, if you have a question now. We are on time, because 5 minutes have been erased from your memory and the memory of the universe. Any questions about any of this? Okay, then have fun with the exercise and see you next week. Bye.